Pet Sematary is a remake of Pet Sematary. That's all you need to know. Alright guys, welcome back to Garage Stephen-King-a-thon, where every day for the month of October we revisit a Stephen King adaptation. If you can sense the enthusiasm in my voice, it's because I just watched the Pet Sematary remake and I have a lot of thoughts on this one. I'm not the type to rant on a movie. You guys know me, it's not something I like to do. You look at the reviews in this marathon, the ones that go for very long are the ones I like, and the ones that are kind of short are the ones that I don't like, because I don't like railing on how much I don't like a movie, but I have a feeling this might be a long one, because I feel like there's a lot of lessons to be learned from this movie. A lot of missteps can show you how to make a good horror movie. So if you're a storyteller, hop on board, let's walk through this one. I need to get this out of the way. This is totally off topic, but my brain goes on tangents. I'm going to try to get this one out of the way early. But Jason Clark, this actor, the first time I saw him, I thought he was the guy at the beginning of the music video Hook by Blues Traveler. Tell me they don't look the same. Tell me they don't look the same. Is it just me? Alright, let's just get started here. Basic premise of this movie. Pet Sematary. You have this family. They move into a new house away from the city. They're starting to live in Maine. And they realize that in their backyard, there's this pet cemetery. And if they bury someone in the pet cemetery, they come back to life. It poses this ethical issue. Is it okay to bring back the dead to the living? That's the whole premise of Pet Sematary. I reviewed the movie back from 1989. I reviewed that movie, I think it was number 14-ish on this marathon. So go watch that one before watching this one. The first thing I notice about this movie is the dialogue. The dialogue is very exposition heavy. And not only is it exposition heavy, but it's very paced unevenly. Just to like put it in respect to the previous movie, and I understand this is its own movie. When you compare this movie to the original, I would say the first hour of the first movie occurs in the first 10 minutes of the remake. Everything is so condensed so rapidly. We're introduced to this family. We're introduced to the dead kid who dies. We're introduced to the pet cemetery. The cat dies. The cat comes back to life. That happens really quickly in this movie. And so what happens? All your big plot points happen very early on in the movie. And there's this whole stretch where nothing else seems to happen very much. There's this whole stretch of emptiness where all what happens are a series of haunted house, ooh, ah, spooky. I don't mind scares in a movie. It's like a comedy to me. The pacing of a comedy is very similar to the pacing of a horror movie. You have to have the plot advance, joke. Plot advances, joke. Plot advances, same thing with a horror movie. Plot advances, horror scene. Plot advances, horror scene. Plot advances, and the more you intertwine those together, the better your horror movie is gonna be. This movie, all the plot is in that first 20 minutes, and the rest is just scary, spooky stuff. I talked about in the It remake how I find horror in general is usually overproduced these days. And what do I mean by overproduced? Is when you see a house, a haunted house, it's the most exaggerated version of a haunted house you can think of, where the paint is chipping everywhere and there's like ooh-ah! Heard in the background, and the floor you step on is like eah! It's like super exaggerated to the point where a house like that doesn't exist anymore. The horror in this, comparing it to that It remake, it's even more overproduced. There's like creepy kids that wear these ghoulish masks. It kind of reminded me of Halloween 3, where kids wear these ghoulish masks. And it totally doesn't fit in this movie other than, ooh, look how spooky these masks are. Even to the sound design. The sound design in this is even more overproduced. There's a scene where Jason Clark is just combing a cat. That's all he's doing. He's just combing a cat. And it sounds like, That's what it sounds like. And you're like, okay, we get it. It's gory and spooky. We just tone it down a bit. Not everything has to be the spookiest thing ever.
George, you're so stinky. Do you too out there?
This movie tries so hard to constantly scare you. There are scares thrown at you constantly in this movie, but it just numbs you after a while. You're just like, okay, there's like zero buildup because you blew your whole load early on in the movie when it comes to the story, and now you're just giving me a ton of random scares. I'm not scared right now. There are some scenes where they even go a little too overboard to the point it becomes laughably bad. There's a part where I laughed out loud. The daughter comes back to life in this. She's dancing in the living room. It's set up early on in the movie that she's a ballerina. And she's doing ballet as a zombified version of herself. Dancing to the, what was that song called? The Sugar Plum Fairy Dance. Dun 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 dun. She's dancing to that and she's knocking furniture over and going bananas.
Careful. Stop.
That was just laughably bad in my opinion. I actually laughed at that scene and it wasn't trying to make me laugh. That's the risk you run when you try way too hard to be spooky. I have some problems with the portrayal of Zelda in this movie. And guys, I'm not one who gets offended at movies, not at all. That's not at all where I'm coming from. And I don't think the intent of this movie was to be offensive at all. But I feel like the way they handled Zelda in this movie is very borderline offensive. And let me explain. Looking back at the movie from the 80s, the Zelda scene is very terrifying because, first of all, you have the point of view of the child. And is Zelda's disease very embellished in the 80s version? Sure, no doubt about it. But you're kind of observing it through the point of view of the wife's flashback. And when you have a flashback of someone's disease, it's very normal that it's going to be embellished the way it is. And that Zelda scene in the original movie is very terrifying. It's very haunting. And the reason why people get scared from that Zelda scene, sure, it's a ghoulish image. I feel like people get more scared because the thought of degenerative disease, the thought of being in a vegetative state, the thought of being in that situation is such an uneasy situation. It really sends shivers down your spine to be in a situation like that, which is a cool way of conveying horror. I feel like the handling of Zelda in the previous movie is done really well. In this movie, they flat out make her a monster. She's like a Blumhouse monster. She's like crawling and shit and like contorting her body like and it's like to the point where it's like, okay, this is a person with a degenerative disease. Again, I'm not offended by the portrayal, but I can see how someone would be offended by it and it would be completely understandable. But it just goes to show they just felt the need to one-up the original version where they just heighten everything even if there's no explanation needed. That Zelda scene in the first one, it was tasteful, it was haunting, and it was relatable. We put ourselves in that situation. Oh, degenerative disease is something we avoid as humans. It's something that haunts us. In this movie, it's just a scary monster who's crawling around her room, and you're like, eh? What the fuck? Do you guys even get what was scary about Zelda in the first place? This movie takes a lot of twists compared to the original in terms of its narrative. Most notably is that in the original version, Gage dies, the son, and in this version, Ellie dies, the daughter. It didn't really add much to the story at all, other than the fact that the filmmaker got to say, oh, we're doing something different, look at us, we're doing something different, look at us. The ending is different as well. If you guys remember the original one, it ends with the wife being buried in the pet cemetery. She holds a dagger to her husband, and it cuts to black, leaving it a little bit ambiguous. Here, it turns out that the whole family gets zombified, and basically, it doesn't really add much to the story. The changes they do bring to this narrative don't really add much to the story. And you guys are probably thinking, oh, Paul, you're just a nag, you're a film snob who doesn't like remakes. I don't mind remakes at all. When you watch a theater production, look how many fucking times they remade Romeo and Juliet. That shit's been on for centuries. But it's just like every time they, like, sometimes they try to add something new, and sometimes there's a production of Romeo and Juliet that's really good. Sometimes there's one that's not so good because it doesn't try anything new. And there are good remakes out there. Scarface, the one with Al Pacino, that's a remake. The Thing, 1982, that was a remake. In recent years, the remake of Suspiria, that was a really good movie. The remake, and I'm a fan of the original one, and I'm a fan of the remake. I'm not one of these guys who think that remakes cannot be done. It's just that this isn't how you do it. It's just trying so hard to one-up the previous one, but it doesn't really have an identity. What is this movie trying to be? Even the It remake, as much as I harped on the It remake, and I didn't harp on it that hard, I liked it to a certain extent, I just don't think it's the best thing since sliced bread like everyone else thought. At least it had a mind of its own, it had an attitude of its own. It's like, look, I can see where the relatability came with the original miniseries, I want to bring that, but for people of my generation, they had to take place in the 90s instead of the 50s for those flashback sequences, and the portrayal of Pennywise definitely had an identity of its own. It wasn't trying to just be a ripoff of the original Pennywise. The It remake did have its own identity. This one didn't. It really didn't. It's really a useless movie. Guys, I didn't like the remake of Pet Sematary, but don't worry, this isn't the last movie of Garage Stephen-King-a-thon. There's more to come. Hopefully I'll like the next ones. Will I? Stay tuned. More Stephen King adaptation reviews coming your way.